So this is Igor Semaev. He's actually based at the University of Bergen in Norway, where I live. So we have met before, and he's talking about DIGIPASS GO3, which happens to be from the bank I'm using. So this is going to be an interesting talk, I guess.
Thank you very much, Per. Actually, I'm not a password security person. I teach cryptography in my university, but I am a customer of a local Norwegian bank. And once I was given in this bank the device, which is called DIGIPASS GO3. It's a very small device. You can have a larger picture of that. I was given that to do internet banking, to generate one-time passwords and enter my account and pay my bills. Two features of the device are the screen where you can read a six-digit combination after you press this button on the left. Okay. So, this device manufactured by international company Wasker, and it used besides Norway in many countries listed on the slide. And from Wasker website, we can read that it uses strong crypto algorithm like DS, TDS, AES, and supports different kind of authentication. But a detailed description of the algorithm was not published. And when I got it, I got curious what's behind this device. So, and that is the main topic of my talk now. So in my bank, which is called Sparbank Invest, there are three ways for customers to get authenticated. All three are a combination of static and dynamic passwords. Two of them use one-time password, a dynamic password from a security token like DigiPass. Static passwords, of course, are very different from dynamic passwords. The difference is that static passwords may be leaked by some malicious software or by some other means. But dynamic passwords are in some sense stronger, which are dynamic passwords like one-time passwords from DigiPass or other tokens like RSA token, password cards or sent by SMS. And the security authentication is basically is largely based on security of one-time passwords. Okay, what's the security of one-time password? A one-time password is insecure when it's predictable, of course. If it comes to a six-digit combination, it's predictable anyway with probability at least 10 power minus 6 as shown in the slide. Yeah, with this probability. But if predictable with a significantly larger probability given the number of previous passwords, then there is a weakness in the generator. So in this work, I study DigiPass, which was distributed by my bank. But later, I learned that some other banks may distribute some other DigiPass GO3. And it's not necessary that the results of my research are valid for DigiPass. All DigiPasses GO3 from any bank. What I do, I simultaneously press the token and the stopwatch at some regular time intervals. And then I wrote down six-digit combinations and analyzed them and got some conclusions. Before showing you my results, data, and analysis, I say a few words about how it works in appearance. You press the token to generate one OTP. Then during the next 40 seconds, the same OTP is kept on the screen. But then if you press between 40 and 50 seconds, the same OTP reappears. To get a new OTP, you should press in time more than 50 seconds. This means that to get some to get some new sequence of OTPs, you should take small interval of 50 seconds. 50 seconds. And next slide shows what happens at 50 seconds. So this is line with index zero. It's some initial OTP. Then in 50 seconds, next OTP. In 50 seconds, next OTP. If you look at the leftmost digit, you will see that it increases by one, two, three, four, five, then six. When six repeats, so, but in this case, the whole password repeats. You see, then next increase by one, by one, by one, then repeats, and the whole password repeats. And that is always true at the distance 50 seconds. And the distance between a repetition of leftmost digit and repetition of the whole passwords is at most five. That means if you have no repetitions for five passwords, like you have this password, this password, this password, this password, this password, then this password should repeat with probability one. So that's absolutely predictable. Fortunately for authentication security, repetitions are not accepted as valid OTPs by the server. Okay. Let's look what happens at another distance, time distance 63 seconds. Let's look what, on this column. This is just a pattern of repetition. So we have steadily repetition by one, and sometimes this repetition steadily increase by one, but very rare repetition of leftmost digit and the whole combination. So I can say that at this distance, the leftmost digit of a combination increases by one with probability very close to one. So now if you look at another time interval, like 81 seconds, you see that leftmost digit increases by one or two. And if it comes to even a larger time interval, it increases almost every time by two, but sometimes by one. But no repetitions now in the whole combination. Okay, that's enough to get first conclusions in the following analysis. Now, if we denote by T time between generating two consecutive OTPs, and if T belongs to interval of 64 seconds with integer bounds, so A is an integer number, actually a natural number, then the first digit increases by A or A plus 1 modulo 10 every time. And if T is close to a multiple of 64 seconds, then the first digit increases by A modulo 10 with probability very close to 1. So and the first conclusion is that the leftmost digit of the combination is very predictable, of course, and it doesn't contribute to the security. So it may be stripped, simply stripped. Now, actually, in my paper, I got more data, and based on analysis of this data, besides those data shown on the slides, I got the following reconstruction of the algorithm behind this DigiPass. So I think that should be some initial time which is the same for token and the server. It's denoted by T0. And then token, when pressed at time TI, computes the number of 64 second intervals since time T0, since initial time. And mathematically, it's given by this formula. Then the leftmost digit of OTP is just reduction of the number of intervals modulo 10. And that explains a lot of stuff found experimentally. And the rest five digits depends on some secret key. It should be, otherwise the system is not strong at all. And another entry to this function is the number of 64 second intervals. And that explains, for instance, a repetition of the whole combination when distance between two consecutive pressing is less than 64 seconds, because it might be that AI and A plus one, they are the same. So in this case, leftmost digit concise, but is the rest five digit concise as well? So, okay. Now I looked into rest five digits and found they are not uniform. So overall, in this research, I collected more than 800 OTPs. And I count how often a decimal digit appears in the last five positions. And those positions are labeled by B, C, D, F. And A is a leftmost digit. And look at second position labeled by B. So zero appears about 100 times. One, two, three, four, five, about the same number of times. But if it comes to six, seven, eight, nine, they appear twice less often. And this is the same for all other positions besides B, C, D, E, F. And that has a quite simple explanation. Likely, last five digits are from 20 bits string. And one digit per four bit string, which represent numbers 0, 15. And after reduction modulo 10, you have numbers 0 till 5 appears with probability 1 over 8, while numbers from 6 till 9 with probability 1 over 16. But, okay. Now to describe attack, I need a reconstruction of verification protocol. But one thing is important for verification is handling delay. Assume that T is the time of generating OTP, and T prime is the time it counts for authentication. That may be distant between these two times, and there should be some acceptable delay interval. And this interval denoted, the length of this interval denoted by big T. And I have found by experiment that is exactly 8 minutes. So this very easy experiment, I generated password and submitted it in 12 minutes, for instance. It was rejected. I did it for 10 minutes, 8 minutes, exactly 9 minutes was rejected, but smaller than, exactly 8, but smaller than 8, it was accepted, accepted, accepted. It means that the delay is exactly 480 seconds. Now I'm able to reconstruct verification protocol. Let T be generating time of this OTP, and T prime is time it comes for verification. So now a verifier server finds natural B such that this number of 64 second intervals between this time and this time is between these two consecutive natural numbers. So that find B. As distance between these two numbers is at most this amount of seconds, we can find that this number is belongs to a set of 10 consecutive natural numbers. And because the leftmost digit is congruent to A modulo 10, it's easier for the verifier to find the exact value of A. And then verifier computes five-digit combination X prime and accepts the whole password if coincidence. Okay, now attack against this is a basic attack. It's kind of some mathematical form. So we take for leftmost digit any number, it may be random or fixed modulo 10. And for rest five digits, numbers from 0 till 5 to increase probability of guessing. And submit this OTP for verification. And the success probability based on verification protocol is 1 over 8 power 5. And that is much higher than 1 over 10 power 6 that one may expect if consider all digits of OTP independently and uniformly distributed. Okay. Now, before my conclusions were based on experiments. Now I want to say something based on some assumptions. This is kind of speculation. I want to understand which are security implications of my findings. And I consider worst case for the customer. Worst case for the customer is that static passwords are compromised. It's a very natural assumption. The second assumption that forgery may start after each correct authentication. So now look at what a customer may need. During 1 month, he may need 10 logins to start a session and pay a number of bills, like 9 bills. So that in aggregated should be about 120 authentications per year. But in fact, from my experience, I used DigiPass more often than that. But there are some people who do not use so often. So in this case, the number of possible forge attempts is 120 times number R, where R is the number of allowed attempts after a correct one. And in my bank, R is 3. And I believe that in many banks, this is like that. So now it's very easy to compute probability of at least one success per year. It's given by this formula. And if substitute instead of R 3, you get about 1% of probability of success. One can say that is not a big deal as probability for one customer. But if it comes to several customers, in theory, if attack works against one customer, it should work against several number of customers, maybe for many of them. It's just a kind of speculation. But the average number of successful forged authentications per year is n number of customers multiplied by probability. And that is about 1% of the number of customers. If number of customers is 10,000, number of compromised account may be on the average more than 100. And that is quite a significant number in my mind. Now, I communicated with the company, with Wascom. And besides some other things, I was told that acceptable success probability of one forgery in Norway is 1 over 3,000. And they referred to some document which I wasn't allowed to see. It's classified probably inside a company and Norwegian banks. But let's believe that it's true. Then if I substitute instead of probability, I found acceptable probability, 1 over 3,000, and do the same stuff, I get the probability of success per customer per year is more than 10%. This is much larger, but it's very, very important probability, I think. So that means that for 10,000 customers, the number of compromised accounts should be more than 1,000. It's very big. I think that this figure should be updated to make it lower, to better protect customers. Okay, there are several practical issues and open questions related to this attack. First, some of them are quite easy, and I was able to check it with my computer and my account, but some of them are more complicated to answer. The first is this kind of attack requires access to a customer's account from different computers simultaneously. And that is possible for my personal account because I was able to get my account from two computers. Probably it's possible to get access from more than two computers. So one can say the server may count the number of wrong attempts authentication take measures. I run my attack against my account not so many times, only for 200 times, but no measures were taken against me. So the main question is it possible to submit two or three forged OTPs after each correct authentication within one session? I don't know exact answer to this question. I think it's quite likely if customer's computer is infected by a Trojan. A Trojan, according to, for instance, a semantic website, is a device that can follow, for instance, your keystrokes and transmit this data to some malicious server. So if it's really true, I think this is possible. So in my mind, more research is needed to clarify, especially the last point. Okay, I'm now about to conclude my talk. I think that dynamic passwords is important protection tool and against criminals and big brothers. And they are to be stronger. It's this message of my talk. And the paper was posted on archive in June this year. So thank you for your attention.